Good evening, Kumudini and Ranga. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We can hear you.
That's fine. As long as you can hear.
Right. Good evening, all. I welcome you all to the today's session, Therapeutic Forum. Today, our speaker is Professor Arashadisa Nayaka. First of all, I would like to invite Dr. Kumudini Jayasinghe, President of Sri Lanka College of Internal Medicine, to address the gathering.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ranga. Good evening, everyone. It's my pleasure to welcome everyone to another session of SLSM Therapeutic Forum. And I greatly appreciate the speaker today, Professor Arashadisa Nayaka, for doing this very important topic, insulin therapy, which is actually useful for all the doctors, all the categories of doctors. Ranga will actually formally introduce the speaker, but I thought I will speak few words about him. He's a good friend of mine and also a valued member of Sri Lanka College of Internal Medicine. He has been a resource person in many academic activities of the college, SLSM SR Forum, MEDS, Future Medical Students Forum, and also How to Pass MD, and also Human Care Workshop. So thank you so much for the support that you are giving to the college. And I would like to thank Dr. Ranga Gunasekara for organizing the event, and also Dr. Ranga Gunasekara and Dr. Ushani Variyaperuma for moderating the event today. So I invite all my colleagues and postgraduate doctors and other doctors to listen to this very useful lecture and also join in the discussion afterwards. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam. It's my honor to introduce Professor Arashadisa Nayaka. He is one of my very well-regarded teachers as well. Professor Arashadisa Nayaka is a professor in medicine and a specialist physician. He's part of, he's a past president of both Ceylon College of Physicians and the Gold Medical Association. He's the regional international advisor for the Royal College of Physicians, UK. He's also the international editor of Clinical Medicine, the Journal of Royal College of Physicians, UK. His clinical and research interest includes diabetes, toxicology, and medical humanities. He's an associate member of the Royal School of Music and co-founded the Southern Symphonia, a musical ensemble, which performs at medical concerts as well as conduct music for healing programs. He is also a past finalist of the Chartered Institute of Management Accountants. He has been an investigative journalist for the Sunday Times newspaper in the past. It's over to you, sir. Thank you very much for accepting an invitation and to enlighten us on this topic. Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much, my very dear friends, Kumuduni, Ranga, and Ushani. I have worked with all of you for many years. You're such dear friends of mine. I'm just trying to share my screen. Bear with me. You must tell me whether my screen is well visible. Is this clearly seen to you, everybody? Are you okay?
Yes, sir.
Can you?
Yes, yes, sir.
Ranga, I might, in the little, I might ask you, can you hear me, etc. So just respond saying that you hear me and the slides are clear. Right. So first and foremost, thank you very much, the Sri Lanka College of Internal Medicine, of which I am very proud to be a member, a wonderful academic body, which is taking great strides under the leadership of Dr. Kumuduni Jayasingha. Over this year, you know, we've done some wonderful work, and it is always a pleasure to contribute to the SLSIM. And then, of course, the strength of the SLSIM lies in its young consultants who are very energetic and enthusiastic. And Ranga and Ushani are two such wonderfully gifted and very enthusiastic future stars of Sri Lankan physician landscape. So thank you very much for this invitation. And somewhere along the way, I think I've made a couple of presentations on one particular aspect of insulin, that is, how do you start insulin in somebody and how do you continue from that point onwards? But if you take insulin, I mean, you know, like people, I just read somewhere that 6 people have actually won Nobel Prizes related to their work in insulin. So insulin is a vast subject, and I'm not here to tell you about the, you know, short acting and the long acting and the different types of insulin, etc. I'm just going to address some important clinical aspects of insulin, and wherever possible, I'll back that up with some evidence. So we are just searching answers to a few questions. And then at the end of the thing, we can discuss what's the contents of this. And of course, if it's something outside, and if I do know that, I will be able to tell you. But there might be members knowing the SLSIM, you know, there might be so many members in the SLSIM who might be more knowledgeable than me about some other aspects of insulin, where they will also be able to help us. Right, okay. So let's get on with today's presentation. And if at any time, Ranga, you don't hear me or see me, or, you know, the screen disappears, you must immediately let me know on this or call me on my phone. Okay? Right. So I put evidence-informed insulin therapy. Now, a lot of people talk about evidence-based therapies. Evidence-based medicine is a fairly rigid concept. You know, you have the evidence, you follow the evidence. Somewhere along the way, maybe about a decade ago, there was this concept which emerged, something called EHIC, EIHC, evidence-informed healthcare. That is, we would take cognizance of data from randomized controlled trials and meta-analysis and systematic reviews, etc. But we will consider all factors, including affordability, patient acceptability, social cultural norms, etc. And together with all that, we will make some decisions. So that is the reason I didn't make this evidence-based insulin therapy, but why I titled this evidence-informed insulin therapy. You will realize that though there is strong evidence for some concepts, they may not be actually workable in practice, right? So, and also I'm going to perhaps spend a little time about how we look at things in the present and what the future looks like. You know, our success will always depend on our ability to visualize the future. Now, Kumuduni is a very successful SLSIM president this year because last year she could visualize the future of medicine. So that's why she came up with this kind of program. So it's our ability to visualize the future in many respects, which will help us to perform very well when the future becomes present. Of course, we look at some aspects of the past as well. Okay, Ranga, everything okay? Ranga, everything okay?
Yes, sir, everything is okay.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
That's fine. Right. First question is, you know, like I have this habit of conducting lectures on a question-answer basis. I don't at times go by learning outcomes, etc., which is part of the modern day medical education. This is a tradition which has been developed from Socrates' times. Some of you may have heard of Socrates' dialogues, where, you know, the idea was that if you keep asking questions and trying to find answers to those questions, you will ultimately find the absolute truth. You know, that was the belief in Socratic dialogues. So let's conduct this as part of a series of questions. First thing is, when should we start the patient on insulin? Now, the traditional answer was when the patient has OHA failure. Now, there might be some medical students with whom also I shared this link. And I may have told them also that we start insulin when patients have OHA failure. And you must not get too disappointed that I have actually probably not been very truthful in my answer to that. I may have told you so, but that is actually not quite true. I've been economical with the truth in that. So what is OHA failure? There are two types of OHA failure described. Primary failure is a small fraction of those with type 2 diabetes do not respond to OHAs from the outset. So they need insulin from the outset. That's considered to be primary failure. Secondary failure was defined by this researcher, Pontiroli, in 1989. That is why the phrase NIDDM. Nowadays, we don't talk about NIDDM. You know, when we were medical students, we used to talk about IDDM and NIDDM. Insulin dependent and non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus, but that's no longer used. Now we have type 1, type 2. So secondary failure to OHAs in patients with NIDDM refers to those, despite maximum doses of OHAs, despite full compliance with diet and therapy, are no longer controlled and require insulin to obtain an acceptable glucose metabolism. So this was a definition from 1989. And at that time, if we go back, we didn't have, we had only metformin and sulfonylureas. We didn't have sitagliptin, etc., the DPP-4 inhibitors. We didn't have SGLT2s. We didn't have thiazolidinediones. We didn't have glucagon receptor agonists. We didn't have any of those things. We had only two medicines. We had only metformin and sulfonylureas. And when the patient was no longer being able to control with those two medicines, people considered that OHA failure and started them on insulin. So that was how it was. But traditionally, we still keep talking about the need to start insulin when the patient has OHA failure. Today, we have about, you know, any patient who is on OHAs will have about five medicines in the drug sheet before they are converted to insulin. You might see them on metformin, sulfonylureas, maybe gliclazide, maybe sitagliptin, maybe pioglitazone, maybe empagliflozin, about five types, maybe even acarbose, about six types of medicines we might see, and then we might see those who are getting insulin. Now, I want to emphasize to you that this whole concept of OHA failure is now an empty box. There is nothing called OHA failure. At least this concept is no longer valid. If we look at the literature, the first time in medical literature OHA failure is mentioned, at least what I could find, was from 1957. Paper from some Dutch paper written in Dutch language. There's no English translated abstract even from 1957. So that seems to be the first time somebody spoke about OHA failure. Then very interesting, if you look at, if you search for OHA failure, it disappears from literature at the turn of the century. Around about 2002, 2003, maximum about 2006, there are occasional papers appearing about OHA failure. Then from about 2006, there is absolutely nothing in the literature about OHA failure. But if you look at 1980s, 1990s, there are lots and lots of papers on OHA failure. People have done C-peptide levels, insulin levels, there are all sorts of research on this concept of OHA failure. I mean, that's really strange, isn't it? OHA failure just disappeared out of sight around about 2006 from medical literature. What is the reason for that? The reason was insulin. And even more than insulin, other injectables like GLP-1 receptor agonists, they jumped the queue. They jumped over the other oral hypoglycemics and came forward. The reason why they jumped was our goals of treatment changed along the way. You know, early part of maybe the first decade of this century, the goals of treatment changed. I will explain the goals of treatment shortly to you. From something like blood sugar control to our goals of treatment changed. And when the goals of treatment changed, the injectables actually became more important than some of the orals. So they jumped the queue. So when you have injectables in front and orals behind, the concept of oral hypoglycemic failure, where we try everything possible with the orals and then go to the injectables, that concept becomes invalid. Therefore, I propose to all of you, maybe you've already done this and maybe only people like I talk about OHA failure nowadays, but I propose to you that the time to lay to rest the term OHA failure has arrived. We should no longer be talking about it. OHA failure. The reason is, this is what I tried to explain to you. Now, till about the first decade of this century, till about 2005, between 2000 and 2010, our entire focus was on glycemic control. If you look at some of the very early wonderful trials done on diabetes, things like UKPDS, they spoke a lot about the potency of each medicine to achieve glycemic control. And the idea was, if the blood sugar is controlled, then we can control people, we can stop people getting heart attacks, strokes, kidney failure, retinopathy and blindness, vascular disease and neuropathy and, you know, amputations, all that. So we had this thing in between. So we had the disease, diabetes, we had the complications. And in between, we tried to control the disease from going into complications through glycemic control. But over the past decade or so, our treatment goals have changed. Now we specifically look for, are there medicines which can preferentially reduce atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease? ASCVDs, atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, this refers to strokes and heart attacks, etc. Are there medicines which can preferentially reduce these? Like something which can act beyond glycemic control. So we know that GLP-1 receptor antagonist, that's glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor agonist, and SGLT2 inhibitors, they work over and above the other antidiabetic medicines for ASCVD prevention. Then for CKD prevention, we know that SGLT2 inhibitors, not all, but some of them, like dapagliflozin. There was a, you know, very famous trial called the DAPA CKD trial, and others, there are some others as well. So for CKD prevention, SGLT2 jumped the queue. You know, it is not, sorry, for ASCVD prevention, GLP-1 jumped the queue. It is above, it is ahead of the sitagliptin, it is ahead of pioglitazone, it is ahead of a lot of other oral medicines, sulfonylureas, it's ahead of that. Then of course, still, if we are not going specifically for CKD and ASCVD prevention, we go for glycemic control. And for even for glycemic control, GLP-1 receptor agonist is a very potent medicine. it is more powerful than some of the oral hypoglycemic agents like sulfonylureas and DPP-4 inhibitors, sitagliptin, and the thiazolidinediones, that is pioglitazone. So because GLP-1 receptor agonist is more powerful, it has jumped the queue and come forward for glycemic control before orals. Then, of course, weight management also for people to lose weight. You know that, I've forgotten to put that in brackets. Something like GLP-1 receptor agonist is a very good medicine for diabetes people to who are obese to lose weight. So when you look at this slide, you understand why this concept of OHA failure is no longer valid. Because when we have certain specific treatment goals in mind, we bring forward some of the injectables into above the orals. So we don't wait till using all the orals and getting exhausted. And even the terminology now, I mean, as a student and probably as a registrar and even as a consultant, I always thought, now we use A, like GLP-1 receptor A for agonist and antagonist both. Now that is very confusing. So the standard that is adopted in many places is you use A for agonism and I for inhibition. You don't use the word antagonist. So I think that's a good nomenclature to use for us to get used to as well. Because natang GLP-1 receptor, you're not sure whether it's an agonist or antagonist. And then you have to think about the physiology and then only figure out, oh, it's an agonist that we are talking about here. So shall we say in the future, there's nothing called antagonist. You have agonists and inhibitors. So GLP-1 receptor agonist and SGLT2 receptor inhibitor. I hope I have made my point about why we should lay to rest the term OHA failure very clear to everybody. Then, okay, if it's not OHA failure, when should we start our patients on insulin? In the olden times, it was OHA failure, but in today's perspective, what? Yes. Now, on the left side of the screen is, I have taken part from the consensus statement of the American Diabetes Association and the EASD. This is the Diabetes Standards of Care 2023. And it goes on to say, insulin has the advantage of being effective where other agents are not and should be considered as part of any combination regime when hyperglycemia is severe, especially if catabolic features like weight loss, hypertriglyceridemia, ketosis are present. It is common practice to initiate insulin therapy for people who present with blood glucose levels of more than 300 or HbA1c more than 10. Or if the individual has symptoms of hyperglycemia such as polyuria, polydipsia, or evidence of catabolism. So what all this goes on to say is, if the blood sugar is very high and we are finding it difficult to control the blood sugar, what we must do is to see whether we must consider the use of insulin. Now, it doesn't mean if somebody has comes with very high blood sugar, maybe HbA1c more than 10, and you start them on some insulin, maybe basal insulin, it does not mean that they have to be forever on insulin. Once the blood sugar is controlled, you may be able to keep them on oral as well. But that is one instance to consider. So this is the standards of care state. And then I've again put for you to have a look at another study, which looks at comparative effectiveness of glucose-lowering drugs for type 2 diabetes, a systematic review and network meta-analysis. And it goes, I have highlighted a little bit, insulin regimen specific glucagon-like peptide receptor agonist, GLP-1, added to metformin-based background therapy produced the greatest reduction in HbA1c level. So it's in small print, but what this meta-analysis, network meta-analysis and a systematic review, what this shows, this is from 2020. This is a publication from 2020 from Annals of Internal Medicine. What it says is GLP-1 receptor agonist combined with insulin and metformin offer the best possible combination for intense glucose lowering. So that, therefore, if I ever ask the question, when should we start insulin in today's perspective? Obviously, if if orals are no longer working, we have to start. But even before we may have to start, if the blood sugar is very high and difficult to control. Ushani or Ranga, okay, so far?
Yes, sir, we can hear it.
Yes, sir, okay, we can hear thanks. You, yes.
Right, okay. So you have somebody who you want to start on insulin. What is the first step? What is recommended by the American Diabetes Association and the EASD is to give a basal insulin injection at bedtime. Basal means a long-acting or an intermediate-acting or a long-acting insulin to be given at night. The aim of this injection is to control overnight and intraprandial hepatic glucose production. Because in the night, there is hepatic gluconeogenesis. A lot of it happens in the night. It's to control overnight and intraprandial, that is between the meals, to control the hepatic glucose production. What are our options? One is an intermediate acting human insulin, NPH or isoflurane, that is one option, which is the less expensive option, or a long-acting analog, glargine U100 or insulin detemer. Now, these are analogs. U100, glargine, there are two preparations. There's a U100 and the U300. U300 is a more concentrated form that is used, that is supposed to be even longer acting than U100 glargine. So we can use one of these two options. And the only advantage so far which has emerged from evidence is there are less hypos with analogs. There is nothing to say that hypos improve cardiovascular outcomes or nothing to that effect, but only the analogs improve cardiovascular output, but it's just a less number of hypos. You may use ultra-long-acting. I told you U300 glargine is an ultra-long-acting. It's even longer than long-acting. Ultra-long-acting, that's U300 glargine or degludec. They cause even less hypos than U100 glargine and detemer. So those are the options that we have. The recommendation is we start maybe about 10 units in the night. If you want to calculate in terms of units per kilogram of body weight, 0.1 to 0.2. So if the patient is very obese, you might have to give a larger dose, calculated on maybe 0.2 units per kilogram of body weight. And the recommendation is to titrate 2 units every 3 days to reach a fasting blood sugar of 80 to 130. Right. Now, there is this concept of over-basalization. We know that insulin secretion occurs in 2 ways. One is the basal insulin secretion and one is with each prandial. Now, if we are giving too much basal insulin, the way to recognize that would be, one is if we need more than about 0.5 units per kilogram of body weight in the night to keep a fasting blood sugar between 80 to 130. If it's a 50 kilogram man, if we are giving about 25 units, you know, we are probably giving too much of basal insulin. If the patient gets symptomatic hypoglycemia in the morning, well, then that's too much of basal insulin. Then the recommendations speak about a differential. That is the difference between maybe bedtime to preprandial or postprandial to preprandial. You know, bedtime has to be high and preprandial has to be low, or postprandial has to be high and preprandial has to be low. So difference between these, if it's more than 50, that means that we are giving too much basal insulin. That's called over-basalization, and that puts a patient at risk of hypoglycemia. Now, at times we tend to take hypoglycemia very lightly. Okay, so what? You know, okay, the patient starts sweating and patient feels a bit, you know, dizzy, and then they eat something and then they get well. It's not quite as simple as that. Hypoglycemia, if the patient has some hypoglycemia, that creates a fear in patients to take medicines. And then they will move away from medicine, and then our blood sugar controls will become very difficult. Or they might become very anxious about the treatment that we are giving, and that itself can cause problems. So hypoglycemia in diabetes is a very important entity. And if there is anything if there's any medicine which is going to cause less hypoglycemia, that is an important medicine. Now, from a cost perspective, human NPH or isophane insulin provides an excellent option. Excellent option. Now, this is what we have in hospitals. We have this in our wards, the human NPH in the vials, and this is what we give in the ward. So this is much less expensive than analogs, and I think a vast majority of our patients can be managed with NPH. And as I pointed out earlier, there is no proven benefit of analog insulin, the more expensive insulins, over NPH in terms of cardiovascular mortality, etc. However much drug companies have tried to prove, they have not been able to prove that. Now, what is NPH? What is isophane? Now, though I have been using NPH for a long time, it always puzzled me, why is this called NPH? And as part of this preparation for this lecture, I actually looked it up. And what does this mean? What does it? So it means neutral protamine hagedorn. Neutral, obviously, not acidic, basic, etc. Protamine, I knew there was something which was going to make the action of the insulin last longer. It's interesting. Protamine is a chemical compound derived. It's a protein derived from sperm of trout fish. And I have no idea how somebody could even imagine that you could get such a compound and add that to insulin. But when you add protamine, it prolongs the insulin action. The two compounds which are commonly used to add to prolong insulin action are protamine and zinc. So these can be added to regular human insulin and prolong action. So NPH, protamine. Now what is Hagedorn? Now that was a real puzzle. Hagedorn is the name of a person. He's the founder of this company called Nordisk. He is the guy who actually bought the rights from Banting and Best for insulin. And there's this big company called Novo Nordisk. So he's the guy who started that company. And he made a revolutionary change, I think, around about the 1950s by adding protamine and prolonging the insulin action so that the previous insulin we had had was all very short acting. And this was the first time somebody could give an insulin which would last about 12 hours, very intermediate. So it's an intermediate acting one. So Hagedorn did a great service to humanity by designing this insulin. So that's NPH or isophane. That's the insulin that we find in the ward. So why do we give insulin? Can't we give lenta insulin? I mean, you know, I know a lot of us talk about giving lenta insulin to patients, and we actually write in prescriptions also lenta insulin to patients. Now, if let's look at what lenta means. One simple answer is we can't give lenta. We can't give lenta to patients. Why can't we give lenta? Lenta is a trade name. It's an insulin zinc suspension. Again, regular insulin. We have added zinc and then made it last longer. And it was manufactured by a company called Eli Lilly. It was an intermediate insulin. And those who are familiar with music will know that lento in Italian means slow. So it was a insulin which had a slower action. Of course, lenta could not compete with NPH. Because of that, lenta production was discontinued in 2005. Because NPH had better pharmacological properties. So lenta is no longer used in humans, and it's apparently now used for cats and dogs because in cats and dogs, lenta works better than NPH. So though we use very loosely the term lenta insulin to the intermediate acting or the long acting insulin that we find in the ward, there has not been lenta insulin in our wards for the past minimum 18 years, probably much longer. So it is time. So this is the second term that I'm suggesting that we lay to rest. That is the term lenta insulin. That is not an insulin which is being produced anymore. So can we give lenta instead as the basal insulin? The answer is no, and now it's clear to you why it is no. Right, so you start a basal insulin, 10 units or so, and then we will check if the HbA1c is not satisfactory, what are our options? One, of course, is to add a glucagon-like peptide 1 receptor antagonist, or GLP-1 RA. Now, GLP-1 RA is a very important injectable medicine. There is one oral preparation as well. The great thing about GLP-1 RA is it has cardiovascular benefit. It has cardiovascular benefit. But it is a very expensive medicine. Liraglutide is available in Sri Lanka. The full dose, which is about 18 milligram, I think, costs a patient about 60,000 rupees a month. 60,000 rupees on GLP-1 receptor agonist only. So that's a lot of money. I don't think as individuals we can afford it. I don't think even as a country that we can afford it. It's just far too expensive. So that's a very important option. I don't think it really is an option for us. How many of us can spend 60,000 rupees on an insulin only? Yeah, GLP-1 and one anti-diabetic drug only. I mean, patient will need so many other medicines as well. So the second option is what we should do, that is to add the short-acting human insulin, that's regular insulin, a human regular insulin, short-acting insulin, or a rapid-acting analog, RAA, like aspart, dispoglucosil, at the time of the largest meal. Start at 4 units or 10% of basal, at the largest meal, uptight rate 1 to 2 units every 2 weeks. Now, this is very important because the largest meal is different in different societies. Now, those of you who have worked overseas will know that maybe in the UK, the largest meal would perhaps be the night time or dinner. Whereas for us, it is the lunchtime bath, which is our largest meal. So depending on which a patient, particular patient's largest meal is, the short-acting insulin should be given at that one. The third option is, if we started NPH, neutral protamine haggedorn insulin or isoflurane insulin, then to convert it to twice daily NPH, 2/3 to be taken in the morning and 1/3 in the evening. The idea is that during the day, we will be eating and then we will need a larger amount of insulin. So that to go for twice daily NPH. Now, this is a very low cost option that we are talking about. Twice daily NPH. Even option number 2 is quite low cost. If we give as the basal insulin NPH and if we give as the mealtime insulin, a regular insulin, that's quite low cost. So that is the second option. That is the second step. The third step would be if by any chance, even with a basal and one mealtime short-acting insulin, then of course our options are two. One is we can go for a full basal bolus regime, initially with 2 and then 3 prandial infections alongside the basal. So, you have prandial infections with each meal and the basal insulin in the night to cover the nocturnal hepatic glucose production and then also to cover the interprandial spaces. So, that's one option. Of course, the patient acceptability of this is very low because it constitutes 4 injections. No one wants to have 4 injections. This is ideal for type 1, but for type 2 diabetes, it's going to be very difficult to convince people to have 4 injections. Then, of course, it could be twice daily. The other option is, as the third step, to go for pre-mixed, that is, the company has mixed and made 30 to 70, or self-mixed. The patient is empowered to mix the short-acting and the long-acting depending on what their fasting blood sugar and the postprandial blood sugars will be. So it will be a pre-mixed or a self-mixed. What you are going to mix will be a short-acting and a long-acting human or analog insulin combination and give 2/3 in the morning and 1/3 in the evening. So the low-cost one will be regular insulin, class NPH. Regular 30-70, always a short acting is the one which is mentioned first. 30 of regular and 70 of NPH. Or 50-50 preparations are also there, 50 of regular and 50 of NPH. The idea is if the postprandial blood sugar excursions are prominently seen, we need to go for a 50-50. Or two reasons. One is if there is the morning fasting blood sugars are very low, then it is better to go for a 50-50. If the after meals blood sugars are very high, postprandial excursions are very high, that are then again to go for 50-50. But that's not a very popular insulin. Usual one is the 30-70. So now this 30-70 is a pre-mixed the company has made. And also there are, you know, things like Novomix will have aspart insulin, which is a short acting. And aspart with protamine. I told you earlier, protamine, which is derived from the sperm of the trout fish, which is taken to prolong action. When protamine is added to aspart becomes long acting. So you have aspart plus protaminated aspart, and those will cause a premixed insulin. The usefulness of premixed insulin twice daily is that it gives a basal insulin coverage, plus it gives cover for breakfast and dinner. Now, the only problem I see in this regime, I know that no one has researched into this, is that our largest meal is the lunch. And when we go for a twice daily premixed insulin, lunch becomes ignored. There is no prandial insulin to cover lunch. And that might be one reason why our HbA1cs are quite high in those who are taking premixed twice daily insulin. Now, what is this self-mixed thing? Can actually patients do that? We teach them to take, let's say they are taking from a syringe. We teach them, they have two vials. One is the short acting, which is the clear liquid, and long acting is the like a Kiripata liquid. So we have two vials and two syringes. We tell the patient, okay, you first draw into the syringe the clear liquid, and then this many units, and then you draw from the other one, the cloudy one, this many units, and then inject in one go. So that way we can actually play around with the amount of regular insulin and the long-acting insulin, the dosing. So is it possible to do this? Is it really possible for our patients to do this? Now, I want to show you all this very important paper which has come from Sri Lanka, which was published in 1997. This paper came from the Colombo Prof. Unit Diabetic Clinic. They actually tried. Those days, we didn't have company manufactured mixed insulins in the hospital. We had only at that time NPH. Professor Devaka Fernando, who I believe led this project, wanted to actually create the kind of mixed insulin that was available at that time in countries like UK by training patients. And they had excellent results in that. I mean, you will recognize all four authors, Rushikal Anarol, Professor Abru, Devaka Fernando, Professor Sharif, etc., Professor Kusumdi Abru, etc. So they were the authors of this very important paper, which appeared in the CMJ. And they showed that actually our Sri Lankan patients can be trained to do that. So even now, I mean, if Professor Fernando could do that in 1997, I'm sure we can do that in 2023 as well, where the need is there. So teach the patients to mix the biphasic insulin in the appropriate combination. Now, I want to take just 1 minute to pay tribute to Professor Devaka Fernando at this moment of time. I mean, you know, my mentor as well. I had the privilege of working with him for many years. Now, he's a shining example for us in the SLSM. Professor Fernando is an endocrinologist in the UK, but in Sri Lanka, he did mostly general medicine with his special interest in diabetes and endocrinology. And the kind of research that he did as a generalist, the kind of research that he did in diabetes is amazing. You know, Professor Fernando probably left Sri Lanka around about 2004. He's been away for about 20 years. I don't think really we've done this kind of interventional, real impactful and research which is going to transform practice ever thereafter. We really haven't done that kind of research. So he's a shining example to what general physicians in this country can really achieve through research in diabetes. So let's all get inspired by Professor Fernando and his work. This is just one paper that I'm sharing. I mean, I haven't seen anything like this thereafter. So we'll keep this mind and move on. Now, there's this question. Yeah, is starting basal better than basal bolus or premixed insulin? You know, so if you broadly look at that, so ultimately we are going to end up with a basal or a basal bolus or a premixed insulin. So people have actually looked at this. There is this this comparison of three. This is a fairly old research because nowadays people don't do this kind of research, but fairly long time ago this was done, 2009, and showed that there is comparable efficacy between these three regimes. So we don't have to necessarily start with to basal bolus regime because patients will not accept that. Now, prescribing insulin is not, as I mentioned right at the beginning, this is in evidence-informed healthcare. So we need to consider two other very important factors when we give insulin. One is cost, because many patients have to bear insulin cost as out of pocket. You know, we know that insulin pens, if there is any patient in Sri Lanka who takes insulin from insulin pen, he is spending money out of his pocket. And on many occasions, insulins are not available in hospital, premixed, etc. So again, patients have to spend money out of pocket. So cost is an enormously important factor, not only in Sri Lanka, but even in the USA as well. It is well recognized that many patients who are given analog insulins don't actually take insulin in the US because they just can't afford that. So that is a worldwide phenomenon. And for a country which is bankrupt, I think that is an extremely important phenomenon. So we need to be very mindful of the cost. That's one. And second is patient acceptability. So if we can get away with one injection as opposed to four injections, which give comparative efficacy, fairly good efficacy, I mean, you know, you can achieve around about the same, then that would be something which is acceptable, right? Of course, having said that, basal bolus will give you that much more flexibility and ultimately in the long run will give you better control. But as a starting point, all three are comparably effective as a starting point. When you do start insulin, what OHA should be continued? Now, that is also a question that we need to grapple with all the time. The general guidelines are, obviously, patient was on metformin because metformin is the first medicine that we prescribe to somebody. So one of the oldest medicines in diabetes, probably the oldest. And to this day, the cheapest, the oldest, and to this day, probably the best anti-diabetic medicine. So yes, continue with metformin, the basal insulin. If the patient is on sulfonylureas and DPP-4 inhibitors, wean them off or discontinue. There is not much logic in giving insulin to a patient who you have accepted is unable to produce insulin anymore, because what sulfonylurea does is trying to produce, get the pancreas to produce more and more insulin. So DPP-4 inhibitors and sulfonylureas, generally recommendation is to be off. Consider adding SGLT2 inhibitors and thiazide-DDR, that is pioglitazone and empagliflozin, if the patient is not already on. Of course, if the patient is a very wealthy one and the country is a very wealthy one, there is a place for GLP-1 receptor agonist to be started even before insulin or be added to insulin. Then, of course, what about insulin pumps? What about insulin pumps? Nice. Very expensive. Extremely expensive. So cost effectiveness is a concern, not for bankrupt countries like Sri Lanka, but for the even for the most wealthy countries, cost effectiveness is a huge concern in insulin pumps. So most trials for insulin pump have been done on type 1 diabetes. It is useful to control type, it has been shown in some trials to be good for very difficult to control type 2 diabetes. And it has been shown to reduce HbA1c more than basal bolus regimen. But it has been tried only not in normal patients with diabetes, but only with those who have difficult to control diabetes. So I think to this day, insulin pump therapy, even if somebody can afford it, will remain fairly in to that niche group of patients who we would say would be very difficult to control with even with insulin, a basal bolus regimen. Now, there are these closed loop systems. You know, there are these have become so advanced that it's a sensor augmented insulin pumps which have two aspects. One is subcutaneous insulin delivery along with continuous glucose monitoring. Now, you must understand this very sophisticated gadgets have two aspects. One is on the one hand, it is continuously monitoring glucose, and on the other hand, it is delivering insulin. It is within the machine, the data, they are communicating with each other in a wireless way. On the one hand, the little bit on the machine, which measures the blood sugar, communicates that information wirelessly to the insulin delivery mechanism. So there is a lot of electronic gadgetry there. And actually, some concerns have arisen on cybersecurity issues because these are wireless connections. Now, if we know somebody is on continuous blood sugar monitoring and insulin delivery through a pump, the easiest way to kill that person would be to mess around with, to cause a problem in that wireless connection. Now, if by any chance the insulin delivery mechanism is given the message that the blood sugar is very high, and they will just pump insulin a lot and maybe the patient might die. So actually that there are lots of concerns about these closed loop systems where if there is a miscommunication or even if there is a deliberate attempt by somebody to interfere with that can actually cause very adverse. I mean, just imagine the president of the US is on a closed loop system and somebody breaks into that and causes the communication to falter, that could be an easy way to assassinate such a person. So cybersecurity has become an issue with insulin pumps. What about inhaled insulin? The inhaled insulins are all analog short-acting insulins. It is, research has shown that inhaled insulins are more effective than analog injections. It causes less hypos. And it is contraindicated in those with chronic lung disease like bronchial asthma, COPD, current smokers. And you need lung function testing prior to starting. Can't be current smokers, can't be recently stopped smokers, etc. So inhaled insulin is there, but it's not really taken up in a big way because maybe one is, of course, the cost. And second thing is, of course, some concern that this may not be, that the lungs may be, the lung functions may deteriorate. Now, that's a serious concern people have. If I were told, you can inhale insulin, but there's a possibility that your lungs might fail, or you can take the injection, I mean, I would take the injection. So that might be one reason, along with the cost, that inhaled insulins are still not where they should be in terms of, if you look at other inhaled medicines like those for asthma. Right. Who is the new kid on the block in terms of insulin? Now, there is insulin icodec. Icodec is an ultra-long acting. Now, we had short acting, intermediate acting, long acting, and now we have ultra-long acting. Ultra-long acting, the previous one we knew was degludec. So ICODEC is, the great thing about ICODEC is its efficacy is comparable. Given once a week, ICODEC given once a week is as effective as glargine insulin, which is a basal insulin, given every day. Now, this research appeared, now this paper which I'm quoting was published in May 2023. That's about 1.5 months back. So that one study, this study has 600 patients looking at that. And then, of course, there was another study which was published in June, less than just about 1 month back. It had about 1,000 patients from what I recall. Let's see, yes, 1,000 patients. So there are two trials which have been reported over the past 1 month using ICODEC once a week to show that its efficacy is that of basal insulin given every day. Now, this is huge. This is big. This is like discovery of analogs. You know, this is huge because this is going to change the insulin landscape totally if the cost becomes affordable. Imagine, every day patients are taking basal insulin. You just take an injection every Sunday and then you are well controlled. Patients would love this. Love this. So this is the new kid on the block. And it's probably the most powerful kid which has come out for a long time in terms of insulin. This is going to change the landscape of diabetes medicine, diabetes control. Two trials coming over the past one. So this is the future that I spoke about. So let's look at that. I'm reaching the last part of my talk. So let's look at the future of insulin. Now, when we want to look at how things are going to evolve in an organization or in a project, we do what's called a SWOT analysis. I've done a SWOT on insulin. I'm not sure whether insulin companies have done SWOTs on insulin, but hopefully, I'm sure they have done. So SWOT is a strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. What are the strengths of insulin? There are two fantastic strengths. It's the most potent glucose-lowering medicine known to man. That's unmatchable. Second thing is, cost is affordable even for a country like ours, even for not so wealthy patients. Forget the analogs. If we go for human insulins, NPH, which we have in the world, the regular insulin that we have, they are quite affordable. So those are the two greatest strengths that insulin has. The most potent medicine and probably the least expensive, not the least expensive, but a less expensive medicine. What is its weakness? The Achilles heel of insulin is, as I told you, the management goals are changing from glycemic control to atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease prevention and CKD prevention. So far, none of the insulins have shown efficacy in these two respects. Of course, they prevent strokes and heart attacks and kidney failure through glycemic control. But there is no added independent action of insulin on ASCVD prevention or CKD prevention. Now, that is where GLP-1 receptor agonist, liraglutide, which is very expensive, has overtaken insulin as an injectable. That is where SGLT2 inhibitors, which are oral tablets, are again trying to go beyond insulin through these actions. But of course, SGLT2 inhibitors, the glycemic control is minimal and it's not comparable to that of insulin. GLP-1, of course, is quite powerful. So that's strength and weaknesses. What are the opportunities for insulin? Now, it is envisaged that insulin costs will come down further, even analog costs will come down further through what are called biosimilars and follow-on biologics. Now, I will explain that in my last slide, what these terms mean. This medicine called Admilog and Besagla, which is available in Sri Lanka as well, marketed by Son of Adventist as Basal Insulin. These are what are called follow-on biologics, and the cost of these are much less than the original basal analogs. So insulin costs are coming down, even analog costs are coming down through biosimilars and follow-on biologics. I will explain what those are later. The other smart opportunity is what I call smart insulins. It is, there is research being conducted at the moment on developing smart insulins, where the insulins will decide if the blood sugar, they will detect, sense the blood sugar, and then decide, you know, how much to be released, how much they are going to release themselves from tissues to control the blood sugar levels. You know, things like nanotechnology can be used to develop smart insulin. I'm sure as we speak, the most brilliant biochemists and nanotechnologists in the world are working on this project. Even as we speak, the best universities in the world, the best research laboratories in the world, the most wealthy pharmaceutical companies are working on smart insulins, which will use those technologies to decide on their own. They will release themselves only if the blood sugar is sufficiently low. So that's in the pipeline. It's expected, I saw somewhere, maybe about 2028, it is expected that there might be smart insulins. Just 5 years down the line. The threats, one is, of course, I've already told you that SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP receptor agonists, GLP-1 receptor agonists, they are both jumping the queue due to ASCVD and CKD prevention. Oral forms of both are available. Insulin is only injectable, inhaled at the moment. Injectable and inhaled at the moment. So those are the threats. Now, I promised I will explain to you what follow-on biologics are, and I will probably conclude my talk with that. Looking at insulin, if I were to ask one final question, what are the potential game changers when it comes to insulin? One is what I described earlier, insulin icodec, which is the once a week preparation. The two large trials have come out in May and June this year. Very hot news. That's going to be a definite game changer, having insulin once a week, which is as effective as 7 days injections. Then, of course, the second thing is, I told you, costs are a major factor when it comes to analog insulin. How are the costs going to come down? Now, I want to introduce three terms to you: bio-better, biosimilar, and follow-on biologics. Now, insulin was discovered by Banting and Best, I think, around about 1920. It has been there for about 100 years. And nothing has happened to the insulin molecule, but we've done a lot of tinkering with the insulin molecule. One is adding protamine and zinc to make it last longer. They're making certain other changes to produce the analog insulins, going forward from porcine and bovine to human insulin using recombinant DNA techniques. We've tinkered around a lot with the same old insulin molecule, and of course come up with better preparations, more effective, and that's called bio-better. You know, we've dealt with the biology to make it better. Now, biosimilar is something else. Something very interesting happened over the around about 2020. Now, there was a huge uproar that the insulin expenses were so high that even in the wealthy countries, people couldn't afford insulin. Now, insulin was classified as a drug along with the other drugs. Now, after about 10 years of negotiations, insulin was reclassified in the US as a biologic. I mean, it is a biologic after all. It's a protein. Insulin is a protein. It's not a chemical compound. It's a biologic. So it has been reclassified as a biologic. Biologic means large molecules, large proteins, which are, you know, very complex molecules. They are not like cisalpha-nylurea, would be a very simple molecule. Those are drugs, and these are biologics. Now, drugs, we know when the patent expires, drugs, we have generic versions. Exactly the same thing, manufactured at a much less cost. Say in India, we get, you know, losartans, and, you know, we have the original rosuvastatin, is, I think, the Crestor. We have so many other rosuvastatins, which are generic versions, which are exactly the same chemical compound as the Crestor, coming at a much less cost. And then we use those and provide good health care to our patients. Now, when it comes to complex protein structures such as insulin, apparently, there is no way that you can actually make, now, say, analog insulins, there is no way that somebody can actually make the exactly the same copy. It is technically difficult, it seems. So what if somebody tries to copy that, what they end up is something called biosimilar, you know, almost that may not be the same. Say if somebody was trying to manufacture something like insulin glargine, they will come up with a product which is very close to glargine, may not be 100% glargine. So because it is not 100% glargine, it becomes biosimilar. And if a prescription is written for glargine at a pharmacy, the person cannot give the copycat one because it is slightly different. Though it is biosimilar, it is slightly different. Now, follow-on biologics means biosimilar products which have had their own comparative testing with the original product to show that there is similar efficacy. Now, biosimilars can be made only after patents have expired. So, even for glargine and, you know, most of the other analog insulin, now the patents have expired. Those companies earn billions of dollars while their rights, patent rights remain. Now, there are biosimilars, not only biosimilars, but some of those biosimilars have been tested against the original and shown to be equally effective. Then they are labeled as follow-on biologics. So it's the same thing, but which has been tested to show equal efficacy. Now that is how the glargine, which is the glargine insulin, which is we had the Basaglar. Basaglar means it's a basal insulin like glargine. Basaglar is a classic example of a follow-on biologic where when the patent expired for glargine, another company, I think Sanofi it was, made something which was just like glargine, which was equally effective, and named it Basaglar. And now Basaglar is also licensed as a similar product. And if a doctor writes glargine, a pharmacist could actually give Basaglar, which comes at a much less cost, maybe about 30% less cost than the original. So that is why I told you that one of the important strengths of insulin is at this moment, human insulin is less expensive. Even analogs are going to become much less expensive in the future with production of more and more what are called follow-on biologics. I hope I have explained this concept very clearly. So, ladies and gentlemen, that brings me to the conclusion of my presentation on insulin, evidence-informed insulin therapy, present and future. What I did try to explain to you was to look at this instance, when should we start somebody on insulin? And when we do start insulin, what is the way that we start insulin? And then once you've started, how do we progress up the ladder in giving insulin? Then, of course, what is the future of, you know, what is the new kid on the block, the Icodec? Then, of course, looked at insulin. I mean, is insulin going to go off one day or is it going to survive? We did a SWOT analysis on the insulin. And finally, we looked at the potential game changers with regard to insulin in the future, which is going to cause great outcomes for patients with diabetes in the future, the ones with insulin and the less expensive analog like follow-on biologics. And in the process, I laid to rest two concepts, OHA failures and Lente insulin. I hope I have been clear. and I shall be happy to take any questions and try to answer them to the best of my ability. Of course, there might be those in the audience who may be more knowledgeable than me on some matters of insulin. They're welcome to join in the discussion. Over to you, Ranga. I hope this has been useful. Please give me an honest feedback. I would love that.
Thank you very much, sir, for that excellent and informative lecture. Let's take the questions one by one. These questions, can we start basal insulin as a second line agent after metformin? If so, what are the indications?
Okay. Yes, there is no bar to starting insulin as second line. What we must understand is there is absolutely no convincing research to spell out this is the order in which we must give that. This is the order in which we must do that. But if on metformin, if the patient has frighteningly high blood glucose, it is quite rational, as you suggest, to start insulin. Of course, the patient does not have to be on insulin forever. You could start the patient on insulin and get the blood sugar control and review your options. But having said that, what we must consider is the goals of treatment. As I tried to describe earlier, our goal of treatment is not merely lowering the blood sugar, but looking at the whole of the patient to see whether there are existing atherosclerotic cardiovascular risk. If it's a high-risk patient, high-risk is considered to be diabetes plus two other cardiovascular risk factors. If the patient is high risk, maybe, yes, you bring the blood sugar down with insulin, metformin, then give insulin, bring the blood sugar down. Thereafter, see whether you want to start the patient on maybe SGLT2 inhibitors. I won't talk too much about GLP-1 because it's so expensive and it's not really a practical option for us. Yes, insulin can float up and down the order, betting order, shall we say, much in the way that Vanindu Hasaranga will do in the Sri Lankan T20 squad, you know, go up and down the order, or like Hardik Pandya does for India. Yes, it can come up when the need arises. That's, I hope I've answered the first question sufficiently.
Yes, sir. Thank you. The second one is, sir, GLP-1 are beneficial in combination with insulin. DPP-4 inhibitors reduces degradation of GLP-1, but DPP-4 inhibitors are tailed off when insulin is started. Could you please explain this paradox?
Again, research is, there is a paucity of research in about what exactly should be continued with these, with the start of insulin. Now, from a physiological point of view, I think you're spot on what you suggest. But if we look at the recommendations from the ADA is what I described, to tail off sulfonylureas and DPP-4 inhibitors, and then to consider adding SGLT2 and GLP-1 receptor agonists. Now, I look to see whether they have given any reference for that. They haven't. I presume that, to be honest with you, I haven't also done an extensive literature search on, because a literature search on insulin is enormous, and we can possibly do that, but it will take a lot of time. I presume we are looking at the number of tablets and the incremental benefit. So probably I don't have a trial to show this, but I think what we are seeing is having DPP-4 inhibitors on board whilst the patient is on GLP-1 receptor antagonist probably does not have any incremental effect on that. That is my understanding. But having said that, I have not seen any solid trials to suggest that. Ideal will be to have two groups of patients. One will be on metformin, GLP-1 receptor agonist, and DPP-4. The other group will be metformin, GLP-1 only, to see and insulin only. So both groups will have insulin, GLP-1 and metformin. One group will have DPP-4. Follow them up and see whether there is going to be any difference, significant difference in terms of glycemic control or atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. I think that is going to be the model of a trial. I don't think such a trial exists in this world. So this is perhaps a consensus agreement of the authors. I've tried to answer it to the best of my ability. Okay, what is the best timing you recommend for NPH insulin BD dosing? What is the best timing? Is it
best timing? Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yes, best timing. I mean, NPH, we know that they are not as rapidly acting as insulin. This is not evidence-based. These are just trying to build up on physiology. And, you know, my friend Panduka Karunanayak always says that, you know, building up on physiology is probably quite important, very important, not to forget in days of evidence-based medicine. I would think that maybe half an hour before breakfast, half an hour before dinner would probably be the best. But having said that, this twice daily NPH, we are talking about Western populations which will have a sort of a smallish breakfast, a sandwich for lunch, and a fairly large dinner. And in our community, we have lunch, which is our largest meal, and that will remain uncovered by this. So that is something for us to think about, whether this or whether we should actually have two NPHs combined with a mealtime regular insulin. You know, that's some for somebody to do that research.
Thank you, sir. And next question, I think it has been already answered. Do you think that in the new era of multiple OHA availability, can we consider insulin-based regimen as superior to 4 or 5 OHA given the fact that some OHAs have proven cardiovascular benefit? I think we have answered, isn't it, sir?
Yes, I think we've already, because, you know, like the way that we look at outcomes has changed. So we look at the patient profile and decide what would be the path that we take. Glycemic control is important, but that's only one aspect of it. Atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease prevention and CKD prevention would be equally important. So yes, so it's a flux. Obviously, if the patient has a high risk for ACVD, they will have to be on GLP-1 receptor agonists as well as SGLT2 inhibitors if that is affordable. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Next question is, there are differences in hypersensitivity reactions among analogs and human insulin.
Hypersensitivity reaction. I have never seen anything to that effect anywhere in the literature. I don't know whether anyone in the audience can actually advise on that. I haven't seen actually. I mean, I haven't seen anything in the literature to looking for a difference between those two. I don't know the answer to that question. I have never read anything like that.
Next question also, sir. What's the place of oral hyperglycemic combined with insulin for type 1, especially metformin and SGLT2?
Oh, I'm sorry. I should have mentioned at the beginning, I'm going to talk only about type 2. Type yes. 1, I mean, I'm not very familiar with type 1 because I don't treat nor read actually too much on type 1. I'm sorry, I am unable to answer on type 1, the combinations. I really have not read. I don't want to, you know, comment on things which I have not really read. Type 1, I have steered clear of, but type 2 is generally the focus of this today's talk.
Yes, sir. And the final question is, sir, can we change back to OHA if patients having good diabetic control with minimal insulin doses?
I think yes, why not? Yeah. I mean, in the sense, because our aims, our goals of treatment are glycemic control with whatever you achieve it. Second thing is atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease prevention, where SGLT2 inhibitors will have a definite good effect. And then CKD prevention, again, SGLT2 inhibitors will have an effect. So we look at our outcomes and then we change there. So if somebody's blood sugar is very high, even at the beginning, use insulin for a short period of time, get it under control. And if you can actually achieve, if we can achieve our goals, there is then that is sufficient. So because as I tried to point out earlier, the disadvantage with insulin is so far it is useful only for glycemic control. Of course, glycemic control is very important, but not for ASCVD. So there is no compelling indication for us to continue with insulin because it is only glycemic control, and glycemic control, if we can get with other things, well, that's fine. Okay?
Yeah. And the last, there's another one question, sir, if you have more time. Why DPP4 is asked to be withdrawn when insulin is started? Again, I think we have went through that.
Answer that question. Eh?
Yeah, that's the recommendation.
I had the same question in mind and I tried to look for any evidence to support this. One is I did a search on my own and I actually... And I looked at that comes as part of the ADA and EASD recommendations. So that's fairly strong. But I tried to look at the references to see whether there's anything which comes from those references, but nothing comes from those references. I think probably that incremental benefit now from DPP4 inhibitor, because if you look at the hierarchy, if we really look at the hierarchy, so it should be metformin is probably number one. Number two is probably a tie between SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP-1 receptor agonists, but SGLT2 will win because it is less expensive. So shall we say SGLT2 will be number two. Number three ideal will be GLP-1 receptor agonist. If it's somebody who can afford it, you know, if Bill Gates gets diabetes or something like that. So that's number three. And number four will probably be insulin because it has very potent glycemic lowering effects. And then, of course, the others will probably be beyond that. So when we add to such a prescription, so we already have four on board, maybe thiazolidinediones also, maybe five on board. And when we try to add DPP4, we are looking at the incremental benefit against a fairly significant cost. So maybe the authors feel that the incremental benefit is not justifiable in terms of patient convenience and cost effectiveness. That is the only explanation I can offer. But that's part of the recommendations, and I can't find any research to support that contention either way. I mean, what happens is like we feel that something should work, but we know that in medicine, when we look at evidence-based medicine, many things which we feel should work don't actually work. And or even they work so mildly that when we look at cost, it is probably not worth it. So that's the kind of approach we are looking at incremental benefit, at what incremental cost and at what incremental patient inconvenience. You know, that's the kind of approach that we take to decide on adding one more medicine.
Thank you very much, sir, for that comprehensive and excellent lecture. I'm assured that it is an eye-opener to many of us. And actually, I learned a lot of points during this lecture. And I thank you again, sir, for accepting our invitation from the college and to enhance our knowledge and our perspective on insulin therapy. Thank you very much, sir. And I thank the audience and the Council of Sri Lanka College of Internal Medicine for giving this opportunity. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you all. Thank you all, to all those in the audience as well. Thank you for being what a wonderful audience. Thank you, Dr. Komudani. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the wonderful talk.
Thank you, sir. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.